Now slides are coming. I just keep
Okay.
full screen mode. Yes, click on it.
Yes, sir, I've clicked on it. I think it's taking a little time. Is that okay, sir?
Yes, perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Chairperson, for those kind words of introduction, and a very good evening to one and all. I shall be talking on the principles of IV fluid therapy and would cover the topic under the following headings. We all know that intravenous fluid therapy is actually the IV administration of mainly the crystalloid solutions and less commonly the colloidal ones. And it is also the commonest of the in-hospital intervention. Do we actually need to talk about it? Have we not been taught about it during our undergraduate, our postgraduate, and in many, many other conferences? Well, it has been evidenced that the errors in prescribing IV fluid was more in the areas where the patient reached first, that is the emergency department, the acute admission units, the medical and surgical wards, compared to the OT and the critical care units. And the reason, well, it was a lack of relevant expertise and knowledge. So the need is surely there. What is even more shocking is this report. The National Confidential Inquiry into the Perioperative Deaths Report in 1999 showed that the significant number of hospitalized patients died due to mismanagement of fluid therapy. And what was even more shocking, that it was never documented as a cause of death. Hence, the recommendation was that fluid prescription should have the same status as a drug prescription. So IV fluid therapy is given in several indications. So a patient may present with multiple indications, or he may come with a particular indication, and during the course of the illness and treatment, the indication may actually change. But the major indications are fluid resuscitation, replacement of fluid losses or free water deficit, baseline fluid needs, correction of dyselectrolemia, IV medication delivery, and parenteral nutrition. The common types of parenteral fluids are the crystalloids, the colloids, the balanced solution, which are either of this, but do not significantly alter the homeostasis or the extracellular compartment. And new to be added to the list of types is the parenteral nutrition. So talking briefly about the crystalloids, these are the solutions which contain small molecular weight solutes with varying concentrations of electrolytes. They're the one which are most commonly used in hospital setting. Based on their tonicity, they are divided into isotonic, hypo, and hypertonic. So of the isotonic crystalloids, the normal saline and the lactated Ringer solution are the best for when it comes to resuscitation. The mixed ones containing glucose are the preferred for the maintenance fluid. And of course, for mild to moderate hypovolemic hyponatremia and as a solvent for IV drugs, they are also used. The hypertonic ones, that is 5% dextrose in water and half NS, are used for correction of free water deficit and for maintenance of fluid therapy if it is a free water loss. 5% dextrose is also used as a solvent for NORAD infusion. The hypertonic crystalloids, the 3% and 5% NaCl, they are mainly used for severe hypernatremia and in treatment of cerebral edema. On the other hand, the crystalloid solutions, they contain high molecular weight substances, which are mostly confined to the intravascular compartment and thus generate oncotic pressure. The natural ones are the albumin and FFP, and the artificial colloids are the gelatins, dextrans, and the hydroxyethyl starch. Now, these colloids surely have a greater effect on the intravascular volume when compared to crystalloids. But then, for fluid resuscitation, they are not routinely used, and there are reasons for it. So IV fluids should have a proper prescription as any other drug. Dr. D. Suresh Kumar was talking of how we should prescribe a drug. We should follow the same thing when it comes to fluid. So we have the 4 Ds of fluid prescription, and the phases of the IV fluid treatment should be used as the guiding principle. So of the 4 Ds, the drug, that is what is the type of the fluid, the dosing, that is what is the amount and the rate at which you would like to give, duration, that is monitor the response and then determine what would be the maximum and the minimum duration, and most important and often neglected, the de-escalation, that is when you will taper and eventually discontinue the fluid. Coming to the management strategies, we have 4. The first is the one which is the patient rescue phase, which is the one which is life-threatening, and so you need to know a lot about it. So this is the intervention given for severe shock, and this you need to work within minutes. The organ rescue phase within hours, where the maintenance of tissue perfusion in patients who are with or at risk of hemodynamic instability. Then you have the organ support phase. That is, here we have stable patients, but now we have to see about the maintenance. We have to manage for the maintenance and for the ongoing losses. At the same time, we also need to prevent unnecessary fluid accumulation. And last is the organ recovery phase, that when we start titrating the IV fluids by reducing it and we evacuate any excess fluid which is there. Monitoring and evaluation is very, very important. So a baseline evaluation, reassessment at various intervals of the clinical as well as the diagnostic parameters. Sometimes it so happens that in our clinical signs and symptoms are not very unclear or cannot be assessed. So you cannot differentiate between a hypovolemia and a euvolemia. So fluid challenge can be done for it. And what is fluid challenge? It's a dynamic test to assess the fluid responsiveness, where you give fluid bolus and simultaneously monitor the hemodynamic effect. The lactate ringer is the one which is preferred, but NS can also be used. 100 to 200 ml over 5 to 10 minutes or 250 to 500 ml over 15 to 20 minutes is given. And there are several parameters, the hemodynamic ones, which we look for either as increase or as normalization, including the urine output. Now, the problem is the fluid challenge, though it is reliable if done properly, it is the most widely used, but then it requires the irreversible administration of fluid, which can actually contribute to excessive fluid administration if you keep on doing it routinely or you keep on doing it regularly to assess your patient. So the Surviving Sepsis campaign has recommended that the passive leg raise test gives us equal and important information like a fluid challenge. And so this should be used in order to find out the prediction whether the patient will respond to fluid or not. For a patient who's on ventilator, the end expiratory occlusion test is available. When you are monitoring, naturally the balance has to be there. So calculate the intake, taking into account the enteral, parenteral, and all other fluid that may creep in with your prescription itself. In the output, look for the GI losses, the urinary losses, and the insensible losses. And of course, both can be assessed with the daily weight changes and the abdominal circumference measurement. Now coming to the various phases and what are the fluids and how do you use it? So the first, as we said, the fluid resuscitation. In this, the glucose-free isotonic fluid is given as bolus. The idea is to replenish the intravascular fluid compartment and the goal is to prevent the organ failure and death. So this is the aggressive phase for hypovolemic shock. So we have divided under two headings. One is the hemodynamically unstable patient, that is those who are in hypovolemic shock. So here, within 10 to 30 minutes, a fluid of 500 to 100 ml is given, that is as a bolus. NS and LR, both are used. We will see later, LR is much more preferred because of its balanced nature. And you can repeat the same bolus depending on the response. But then if you see that this hemodynamically unstable patient is deteriorating or not responding to your fluid bolus, you can consider vasopressors and or inotropes, check for other causes of shock and give blood products if there is hemorrhage. But if there is clinical improvement, then now you start treating him as a hemodynamically stable patient. So what do you do for the stable patients and who are they? They are the ones who had mild or moderate fluid loss and but had inability to tolerate enteral fluid therapy, or the dehydration or hypovolemia was refractory to ORS. And also those people whom you have taken out from an unstable state, now you need to stabilize them. So you need to optimize the treatment. Also very important at this stage is you need to identify the risk factor for any fluid overload. You need to assess the fluid responsiveness either by the PLR or the fluid challenge. Replace the fluid, and here it is set 500 ml, but what would be the rate? You need to titrate the rate as well as the fluid based on the hemodynamic monitoring parameters. But surely now we've come to the replacement fluids, and for the replacement, it will again depend on the fluid loss, what type of fluid loss has been there. Again, if the patient is deteriorating, then go back to the unstable algorithm. If the patient is improving, then go to the next, that is continued fluid needs. So in continued fluid needs, we are only replacing the ongoing fluid loss that cannot be compensated by the oral or the enteral route. So we are aware of these various conditions in which there is a lot of ongoing fluid loss. But what is important is that you need to not only continue the fluid needs or replace it, you have to identify and treat the underlying cause. You cannot keep giving fluid and not take care of the GI loss or the urinary loss. So you need to treat the underlying cause. You need to match the volume of the fluid that you give and the composition of it to the one which is lost. Again, it is not very easy, but such type of tables of various losses and various secretions can be found in any textbook. So you can refer to it to get some idea. And of course, consider the insensible fluid loss. Next comes the maintenance phase, that is the when you are trying to maintain the adequate hydration and organ perfusion. The aggressiveness is now gone. Now what you have to do is you have to take care of these patients who either cannot take or are not allowed to take their daily, meet their daily fluids enterally due to any reason. You've kept them little orally or there's some reason for it. So that is where the maintenance fluid therapy comes in. For the maintenance, the first line is the isotonic crystalloids with dextrose to prevent the starvation ketosis. I repeat, the first line in maintenance is also always isotonic crystalloids with dextrose. But then switch over to the isotonic crystalloids with no dextrose until and unless there is some specialized nutritional support which is required. Also take care whether they require an increased amount or a decreased amount. And this would depend on the other associated factors. There can be some other associated comorbidities or there may be some risk factors for overload. So this should be taken into account during the maintenance. And of course, do not forget the electrolytes. Even at this stage, the electrolytes may be haywire. Also, a very important point to keep in mind, if the patient is on maintenance fluids alone for more than 3 days, it means that the patient requires specialized nutrition or parenteral nutrition. So do not contain maintenance fluids alone. If you've already started enteral and oral along with it, it's fine. But if it is alone for 3 days, it's time for parenteral nutrition or some specialized nutrition in the fluid itself. The last phase, and very important, that is the de-escalation phase. This is the area when the organ is already in its recovery phase and you want to wean off from the IV fluids. So these are the patients in the recovery stage. They are hemodynamically stable.
You have 2 more minutes to summarize.
Yeah, okay, I'll finish. Yeah. They have adequate tissue perfusion and they're capable of enteral and oral feeding and hydration. How do you calculate the dose? One rule is 1 to 2 mL per kg per hour, but then take care of the risk factors so that there's no fluid overload. There's a rule of the thumb, which is easy and most often followed by our residents also and works well. Rate in ml per hour is equal to patient's weight in kg plus 40. However, if the BMI is high, take the ideal body weight. And remember to subtract the other sources which may be creeping in. During the escalation phase, it's not only that you will continue with the oral and enteral hydration, you will restrict and subsequently you will go completely to the oral or the enteral and stop it completely. Along with that, you also need to evacuate any excess fluid which is there, and this is customized. Allow spontaneous diuresis if the kidney function is okay. If spontaneous diuresis is deficient, then use diuretics or RRT, but then be sure do not remove excess fluid and make the patient go into an AKI or a hypotension. It's a fact, again, evidenced. Many of us know the triggers when to start. We are unaware of the triggers when to stop. Hence, we need to be regularly reminded of these triggers also. And thus, often lead a patient to fluid overload and electrolyte imbalance. Briefly on the septic shock part, in the septic shock, the initial phase is the F phase, where there is the hyperdynamic shock with decreased SVR, increased capillary permeability, and absolute or relative intravascular hypovolemia. So the surviving sepsis campaign guideline has given a mandate that you administer fluid at a dose of 30 ml per kg within the first 3 hours, and this would act as a life-saving procedure. Should we give normal saline, and how normal is actually normal saline? Well, it is not. Do not give large amounts of normal saline because it leads to hypernatremic, hypercholeric metabolic acidosis, AKI, and death.
Your time.